Paltrocast.
Hey, Trevor, can you hear me okay?
I can. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I can see you. That is an impressive book collection behind you. How many do you estimate that you've read? Because I'm getting answers like, oh, I haven't read any of these.
No, I've read a good amount of them, but I will say I finished very few books in my life. So I'm a big fan of reading, starting or getting into a book, and then about halfway through losing interest, and then just kind of moving on to something else. So it's not as impressive. I have not read, I've not finished any of those.
I appreciate that honesty. leading in about your show, the Trevor Moore Show, I'm a big fan of what it is that you do. I was wondering, still is the streak going? Is Gertrude the Pig the cattiest guest you've ever had? Because I think the answer is yes.
Gertrude is full of personality. Gertrude the Pig, Elon Musk's, the pig that he's experimenting on with his, hyper?
Brain chip. Thingy.
Yeah, I forget. He's got so many companies. I forget what that one's called. We had James Adomian was a guest on playing Gertrude the Pig, and it's always fun when James is on because James just kind of takes over the show, and it's great.
Excellent impressionist beyond that voiceover gig that he does for you every now and then. So credit goes to you for having a show that's very funny. It's very quick-witted. It gets deep and dark at times, whether or not it's kind of planned to be. I'm wondering how much of the show is written on paper and you give to the Comedy Central people versus them going, do it. We know you're funny.
That's a good question. It's we have to show them we show them everything we're going to do. The conversation they don't know, because a lot of times when you see that they'll be yelling in my ear, it's when the conversation has gone down an avenue that they didn't like. But the bits are all pre-approved. We do the show in an interesting way where, you know, I meet with the writers and the producers and we talk about what we want to do for each episode, and are kind of like, okay, then we'll do this segment and do this segment and do this segment. But then I like intentionally want to know very little after that. I almost want to have forgotten about what we're doing on the show. So that way I have to rely on the cards, because I like the energy that has, where it all feels like, you know, it's kind of going off the rails.
Without pulling too much of the mystery away, is what's on the computer screen of your co-host, Sam, is that anything to do with notes or what's going on? Or is that actually not even turned on?
I have no idea. I think it is on because there's been like one or two episodes where he's like looked up something and said it. But I think it's just a web browser. Like it became a joke sort of like, you know, where like what is Sam? It's redundant that we have two hosts. So it's like, well, what is Sam doing? I think there's one episode where I forgot that he was there. Like if you watch the episode where we have a psychic on, Patty Negri, and she lifts the veil, and I'm asking people if they believe in ghosts, and I just ask our guest, I ask Blair, and then I move on, and Sam's kind of like, wait a minute, are you going to ask me? And I like literally forgot that he was on the show. I don't know what he's looking up. Like, I think he's just like on Facebook.
Well, it's interesting to me as somebody who grew up addicted to talk shows. And of course, as podcasts got better, lost a little bit of interest in talk shows. But it's awesome to see that you and Sam both have the pencil cup on the desk.
Yeah.
Because why would anyone need that there? Like everything is on the printed cards there. I don't think anyone ever called out Conan or Letterman. Like, why did you need like four pencils?
Yeah. Why do they have a desk? Like what is with the office motif that we're going here? Like, you know, like, it's funny. Cause like talk shows are this sort of antiquated thing now where like, I don't even think you can pitch a talk show anymore. Like they sort of like podcasts have kind of eaten their lunch, and now like every network has one, but like none of them get ratings. So it's a weird dinosaur format. That's like, but it's still, it's a fun format. So, but it's hard to do something new. So we're just like, well, let's just have ours feel like it's very unprepared. Even though we do prepare, we'll just have it feel like almost too loose. kind of thing.
Well, to your credit, and another thing growing up as a big comedy fan that I saw is people only did sketch, they only did stand up, they only hosted. And then you, yeah. you know, come from the Whitest Kids You Know. Mm-hmm. That's one thing. You've done albums of your own stand-up and music-related stuff. You have this. So you're able to go between all those platforms. And now we see people from Kids in the Hall hosting, doing stand-up. They kind of show that they can do it all. People from the state, they now do stand-up. I'm curious, when you started doing sketch in the first place, did you feel limited like that? Or am I just making up these labels?
No, I don't think, I didn't feel limited, but I don't think you're wrong in making up those labels either, because I think that's, but I think that was the culture of really sort of the baby boomers, like, and how they can, like the stand-up scene in the 70s and 80s, it was very linear. Like you were either doing sketch or you were doing stand-up, and the stand-up comedians would eventually become the late night hosts. Yeah. And that's how it went. And then everything, you know, that was when it was really just networks. But then once cable got involved and you started to get things like the state, like, you know, Kids in the Hall, and everything became a little more fluid. And suddenly you had people who were doing both. And now, I mean, if you look at the late night talk show hosts that are out there now, Jimmy Fallon isn't a stand-up, he's sketch. You know, Stephen Colbert wasn't a stand-up, he was sketch, you know, and Kimmel was a radio guy. So it's kind of opened up where now there's not really a stand-up in late night. It's kind of switched to being all sketch, which is odd.
Yeah, Craig Ferguson wrote movies and sort of was a punk rock guy named Bing Hitler that got into stand-up. But you can't really say he was a pure stand-up. That's a really good point.
Yeah, Corden, I think, was doing plays. I don't know what Corden was doing, but like...
musicals.
He's doing something in England.
Whatever it was for you, was the original plan to be a long-term sketch guy? Was there originally a plan? That part, I didn't want to go on Wikipedia and go, what did Trevor do and what's coming up according to his IMDb page? I wanted to focus on the show and then see, what does he tell me?
Yeah. So as a kid, I was obsessed with David Letterman and Weird Al. David Letterman and Weird Al. So I always kind of wanted to do a kind of a late night thing. So I did a public access show when I was a kid. And in the public access show, I just started doing more and more sketch. I started out doing like desk bits, like kind of like Letterman. And then I would start doing more sketch, got into it. And then when I went to LA and did stand up for a little bit. And then when I went to college, I started Whitest Kids and then really kind of fell in love with sketch. And then I was just like, and I still think sketch is kind of the least limiting format, because you can just get in. I mean, I think of sketches as like songs. So like you don't want them to be more than 2 or 3 minutes. You get in, you know, you hit your premise, you attack the premise from as many angles as you can, you get the best jokes out of it, and then you just end it and you get out of there. Like you're not stuck, like, you know, doing a segue to another bit, like, you know, a stand up, everything has to start. So it is really kind of freeing where you can just, it's chaos. So you can just come in, hit all your jokes and get out of there. And sketch also gives you the ability to go into music. You know, you can just do a music, you know, thing. There's sketches that we've done, which that I tried out as stand up first. And then it was like, oh, let me do this as a sketch. And then a lot of, you know, I was doing music, like a couple songs every season on the show. And then I did that before I ever started releasing music albums. So, you know, sketch is kind of the best of all worlds. You can do it all there.
I have a Weird Al question or two coming as a result of that early.
Oh, okay.
But did you have a pencil cup on your desk when you're hosting as a kid on public access?
I'm sure I did, because I just copied everything to a T. Like even like mannerisms, like I was just copying what I'd seen at like on like Letterman or, you know, or like you could guess Leno at that point. But like, yeah, it's just kind of, I'm sure I had the pencil thing. I am sure like the tie, the microphone that wasn't plugged into anything. I'm sure I have to go back and look, but I'm sure I did all of it.
One of my projects in the midst of COVID was looking up interviews that I did when I was 18, 19, 20 years old, maybe 17. And they're terrible, but some of the people some of the people are icons. Like some of it, hey, it's better to digitize that than let it, you know, rot into the ether because some of these people passed, like Joan Rivers and Don Rickles. Like I had that as a kid, but they're terrible. Looking back at that stuff when you were a kid, is it cringeworthy or is it funny?
It's both. It's mostly cringe. But then there's like bits in it where I'm like, that's a solid bit. That's a good bit. Like, you know, like, when I look back at it now, like a lot of it was like local humor. A lot of it was very offensive. You know, just as times change, like where, you know, like, but like what kind of struck me by it was, you know, what's like evergreen is prank calls, just making, calling random people and just messing with them, that stuff. And I did a good amount of that on my show. There was a regular segment. That's kind of what my show became, like kind of popular locally. And then it got bought by a PAX television affiliate. So I left college for a year to do, I got hired to do my public access show. And one of the first bits that got popular was one of these kind of prank call bits that I would do. And that stuff always holds up. I mean, just messing with random people, it's, you know, you can, that bits that you did like 20 years ago will be still funny 20 years from now.
So you said Letterman and Weird Al were top influences, but I'm guessing Jerky Boys number 3 or number 4.
You know, I didn't listen to a lot of. I mean, I was aware of Jerky Boys, that was always, there was one guy at our church who always had the Jerky Boy tape, and then after church we'd go out and hang out in his van and listen to Jerky Boys like that. But I don't think they had the impact that Letterman or Weird Al did. Yeah,
and then speaking of Weird Al. Hey, I can relate, except the Jerky Boys are higher up. And my wife and I at our wedding, like we had the music stop at a certain point to play a Frank Rizzo phone call. Actually, no, a Sol Rosenberg phone call. Nothing halts a wedding like that. But So you mentioned Weird Al before being a big influence. Same here. Love what Weird Al does. But how old were you when you realized that all the originals were stylistic parodies? Because I didn't realize that until like 5 years ago.
Oh, the originals were stylistic parodies. Yeah.
Every single one of them was a stylistic parody of a particular artist.
You know, I don't know that I definitely knew that some of them were, but I don't know that it's ever clicked until right now that every single one was. There's definitely, who was I just listening to? It was, have you heard of W.C. McCall?
Yes.
He does the song Convoy.
Yeah.
You know, we're gonna do the convoy. I was listening. I've gotten really into like 60s and 70s country recently. Sure. So I've been going through and like listening to all of Zach's. And he does. There was a regular thing that W.C. McCall would do where it's Biggest Ball of Twine in Minnesota.
Great song.
And I had no idea that. I thought that was just kind of a brilliant thing that Weird Al did. And it still is brilliant, but like also, Albuquerque, these songs where he just talks and
Frank
talks
Zappa
and talks.
Song.
Yeah. And he just, I heard Biggest Ball of Twine. I was like, oh my God, that's W.C. McCall. That's what he was doing. That's the joke he was making 40 years ago or however many years ago it was. That's the Weird Al. It's a puzzle. You keep learning more. Well, I was from a very religious family. And so I wasn't allowed to listen to much secular music. And so there was, I mean, all through my life, I still hear songs that were on his polkas, you know? Yes. And then I'm like, okay. That's from the polka. Oh, so that's how that song really sounded. Okay. Like, you know, so that still happens.
Yeah, when I was 9 or 10, I heard the polkas on 45, which is mostly the Rolling Stones and Foreigner. I was too young to know most of those songs. And then eventually you're listening to classic rock radio and you hear Hot Blood and you go, oh, that's a real song. Weird Al inspired my comedy, my music, everything. And it's interesting to me how many of the comics who came out of projects on IFC and Comedy Central these days have worked with Weird Al in some capacity. They get a cameo from him. They get him to do something on it. And have you?
No. He wrote me a letter when I was a little kid, and which was very nice. And I was on, IFC did a special where they were, you know, kind of, it was like this weird thing where they were kind of giving Weird Al a Lifetime Achievement Award for comedy music. But it was weird. It was a weird special. And they would do little segments on other musical comedy people. And I got asked to be in a set. They wanted to do a segment on me, and I was psyched because I was like, "Oh my god, you know, I'll get to meet Weird Al." But then the way they taped it, I never saw him. Like he was there on like a different day, so I was bummed. But no, I've never met him.
He seems to be one of those people. I'm editorializing here, where it's like everything that he does either pays a fortune, or he does it for free because he wants to do it. Hence why he's on all the comedy podcasts. And, you know, he's in Auntie Donna's. Did you see that series on Netflix?
No. He does that. I think he's good friends with Jonah Ray too.
Yes.
Yeah. He's a guy that I've never heard a single negative thing about.
Exactly. You
know, there's a couple of guys like that like, and, you know, this is a town that loves to spread negative things about people like that, but not a single utterance of anything south of glowing about that guy.
So. I think Trevor Moore is also on that list of
glowing, oh, I hope.
Universal praise.
So, I hope.
So that's where your influences come from. So bringing it back to you here, is this show, because obviously when you integrate Zoom and all that, it's a pandemic era show.
Yeah.
But is this the long-term thing that you want to do hundreds of episodes of?
You know, it's weird. Like, I kind of don't think that way. So we did the first season like two years ago. Then the pandemic happened. We were actually supposed to shoot the second season right before the pandemic. And then the pandemic happened. And so then we came, and then at around October, things were okay for a little bit. So we got back in the studio and started recording some stuff, and then it got real bad. And so then everything had to shut down again. So, you know, I like these episodes. I'm really proud of this season. I like this season even better than the first season. I'd love to do another season, but I'm kind of like, you know, right now we're putting the finishing touches on this Whitest Kids movie. So I kind of just go from project to project. And as soon as like that's done, then I would love to go do another season. So then I'll talk to Comedy Central at that point and see if that's works with what they want to do at that point. So, I don't know how I feel about doing hundreds and hundreds of episodes of anything.
Well, I find that there's two schools of thoughts of like working comics. And the one is like the Letterman or the Seinfeld, putting aside the hundreds of millions of dollars in the bank, putting that little detail aside, and the fact that they don't ever have to do anything again. They're both people who do one project at a time and spend years toiling away on it. And then there's the other person that's the plate spinner who has 12 things in the air, Mark Duplass style, and they're delighted to do that. You sound like the latter, where you go between Whitest Kids, the show, your albums, you said you have a writing partner, and you're content doing that.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like, I just, for the last 7 years, I've been creating shows for the Disney Channel. So like, I've been doing that, and then focusing on the albums, you know, and the comedy specials. And like, now I've kind of moved over to the movie. And you know, I like the talk show. I would like to get another album in there, like in the next year or so. So I'm kind of just kind of moving, you know, as the flow goes. But I don't know. But then again, somebody wants to pay me, you know, to do like 100 episodes of it, I'll do it. Sure, that'd be fun. I mean, I love doing that show. It's very fun to like, you know, sit there with Blair, Sam, and just kind of you know, chat with just friends. Like, I'm bringing on, like, we're just bringing on like comedians that like we're buddies with. So it's you know, you can't beat it. It's one of the most fun projects to do.
Well, two more questions. One's longer than the other, if that's fine by you. And sure. Then man. The first question, the longer one, mm-hmm. is, again, as a person who just watched way too much comedy, way too many talk shows, I can compare the Trevor Moore Show in an excellent way to the MTV Tom Green Show, in that here's the host who's funny, mm-hmm. who's leading the ruckus. Here's the co-host who's going to get tortured more cases than not.
Yep.
And then here's the third person who laughs a lot, who adds to the jokes, but is just always laughing. I think his name was Phil, Tom Green's other guy. And
wow.
Sam being the Phil Humplick kind of person there, who you know is super talented, but he's mm-hmm. there just to kind of get crapped on. Pure coincidence?
Yeah, absolutely. I'd never thought about that before. It's funny. So the executive producer for Whitest Kids was also the executive producer for the Tom Green Show.
Oh.
And I was just chatting with him. Whitest Kids does a Twitch channel, official WKUK at Twitch, where we each night somebody hosts a show and then we all do a show together on the weekend. And so I was interviewing our executive producer a couple weeks ago, and we started talking about Tom Green Show, and it was interesting to be like, that's such an underrated show, I don't think people realize how important that show was. Like, it kind of gets skipped over and people kind of go straight to Jackass, but it really did. And this is what we're talking about. It really did bridge the gap between David Letterman and modern comedy, like Eric Andre and stuff like that. It really was the connective tissue that, like, you know, because of that, Jackass happened and all that. And that show is fantastic. I don't know why it's not, like, available. I guess MTV always has problems with their rights because they put music under everything.
Yes, the music beds.
Which is a shame because there's like a whole generation of comedy that's pretty much lost.
Cut you off there. Even before that, do you remember the MTV show Buzzkill?
Yeah. Yeah.
Buzzkill was kind of, I thought, what bridged the gap there. And then even though two or three of the three guys all went on to do a lot of projects, none of it was under the Buzzkill name. And that's 80 times more forgotten about than the Tom Green Show.
Yeah. Buzzkill. That is totally. I just remember the logo. And then I remember they would do big bits with like huge crowds running around corners and stuff like that.
Happened. I think one of them parlayed it into Trigger Happy TV, which is
maybe that's what I'm thinking of. Maybe that's
Buzzkill was the three of them. They were like these punk rock guys in a van, and then they just show up on the camera, prank people, and it was usually cruel, but I guess in the Jerky Boys era, you could be that.
Yeah, yeah. Oh man, I totally forgot about the show. That was completely coincidental. But I'm sorry, I just went off on a thing. But I interrupted you.
My bad.
No. I mean, I just went off on how like the Tom Green Show was great, which it is. Like, it's shocking to me that I guess people of the generation remember it, but it's sad to me that like younger people don't know it because that was a hugely important show.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And then the next question, the last question, should be an easy one. And that's, besides the Trevor Moore Show, what's one show that we should be watching if we need a new show to start? And it's fine if you name something that you created. That's totally acceptable.
Oh, I wasn't gonna name one of my shows. I do Disney Channel shows. Like, that's what I've been creating recently.
Hey, Disney's cool to tens of hundreds of people. So
let's just roll with it on Disney Plus. That's Narcos. Narcos Mexico. Oh my God. That's my favorite show. Maybe my favorite show ever made. Like, but that's my sweet spot. I love drug cartel stuff. Like, if there's a drug cartel in it, I'll watch it. Fiction, fact, I don't care. I love it. That's my genre.
That reinforces the stereotype that comedians don't watch comedy.
I never watch comedy. I don't like it. I don't care for it. Like, you know, like, I mean, I like making it, but I haven't seen a comedy for so long and people are like, you should watch it. It's really good. You're like, I just don't like it. You know,
that is the best answer I could have ever gotten. Trevor, I can't thank you enough for your time. Keep up all the greatness and really, the Trevor Moore Show is one of the greatest discoveries. Unfortunately, it's a late one for me, but 2021, it's at the top of the list right now.
Comedy Central's YouTube. Check it out.
Thank you, man. Have a great rest of the day. We'll get this posted very soon.
Thank you. Great talking to you. Paltrocast.